Good morning, everyone. We are right now 67. That's a big, good number, and I'm very happy considering the stalwarts today and the subject of importance. People have been very enthusiastically on this Saturday morning been coming forward over. Well, so just sharing about the Think Tank series. It's an initiative which we appreciate, like Manoj had started, or Lim Chandani. And after that, it's been 10 years since we have been having these sessions. We are happy to have a lot of good people like who are into senior positions of CFO, CXO, COO, CEOs, and senior positions who've been with us. We are really thankful to all of them for sharing their part of the knowledge and enriching us into the scenario. Okay. So before we go, I would request Manoj to share his thoughts on the subject and take us ahead.
Thank you very much. Indeed, a pleasure and honor to be here with a galaxy of eminent panel and superb participants. We have eminent experts among participants with a great knowledge about corporates, banking, finance, capital market, industries. And today we have indeed a wonderful panel. We are beginning a new year. I wish Happy New Year and a great 2021 to all the participants and the panelists and everybody watching the Thank You Conclave. I would like to acknowledge all the participants. It's really a full house. The series initiated by the participants themselves. The topics have been selected by the participants themselves. Have received overwhelming response, and there is a request to continue the series. I was talking to a few participants and expert panel speakers last evening. Everybody has appreciated very much, and they are very, very keen to contribute to the development for the India growth story and through the digital means of knowledge sharing and experience sharing. Wonderful to have. Shailesh, just one word for you, from you on the overall finance and banking conclave, then from Ramesh and Mr. Rathi, then we start the presentation by Sanjeev Pandeyji. Everybody is looking forward to it.
Okay. Thank you, Manoj. Wish my colleagues a very happy new year. I must admit that participating in these knowledge series is truly enriching. I have had the opportunity to participate in quite a few of them. Manojji has been very instrumental. I'm sure there are other members, but I think there is a lot of hard work that goes on behind it. I look forward to sharing my experiences and learning from the experiences of other members. I think it's a great opportunity for people to share their views and learn from each other's experiences. I thank the Think Tank series, Manojji, and all the other members for this opportunity, and I look forward to hearing all members. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Ramesh?
Yeah, thank you, Manojji. A very good morning to all of you, and wishing you a very, very happy and prosperous and very safe 2021. It has always been a pleasure to interact very, very. We have had very informative sessions in the past few months. I think each session really enhances our knowledge, and we are much better off than as we go by every session. So today, I think, as many of you would know, that I have a credit ratings background. Like in the IBC case, when IBC was getting implemented, rating agencies were pulled in, saying that the company which goes into IBC also need to get it rated. Similarly, RBI has kind of brought in the role of rating agencies in this restructuring as well. Presently, I am not, earlier I was with CRISIL, so I had first-hand knowledge, but I have been interacting with my friends in the rating circle, both in CRISIL and in other agencies as well. So I have some interesting thoughts to share with you. So once I think the subject is introduced and other speakers have come, have spoken, probably I would like to share my whatever I understand what's happening in the market regarding the restructuring, regarding the rating part of the restructuring. So wishing eager to hear from all of you first.
I would like to introduce Sanjeev Pandey, the speaker for the day. Sanjeev Pandeyji is the DGM handling NCLT at State Bank of India. He's been a stalwart in this area and has been providing a lot of good inputs on the subject. I would now request Sanjeev Pandey sir to share his screen and start up with this session and enlighten us with the knowledge what he has. Thanks a lot, sir. Welcome, sir.
Thank you. I'll start with a happy new year to all of the participants and thanks, Think Tank team for having me here. So welcome all of you to this webinar on restructuring and NCLT. So let me share a brief of my background. Like I was had an opportunity to work with IBBI initially. So when IBBI was set up in December 2016, so I was one of the first, second or third employees after Dr. Sahu. And we were like very actively involved in the drafting of regulations. And I'll say that I was the organizer and the mover for the regulations on CRP, liquidation, voluntary liquidation, fast track, as well as information utility. So of course, regulation have been having a lot of changes frequently, and even the code has got already 4 amendments. But I think code has been a paradigm change in the restructuring framework in India. Restructuring, as we can see, is as old as the credit. Like, you can say default and restructuring come with credit. So I think the history of credit may go back to maybe a few thousand years. And default has happened as the credit has happened. And now restructuring is the part of like rescuing the credit without going whole hog into the recovery equation. So let me go briefly into the background of restructuring in India. So as we all know, the original restructuring act in India was the SICA Act, which was passed in 1985, and BFR was set up under that. And it worked for some time, but ultimately the people got smarter and they started using it as a sanctuary. Basic flaw with the BFR was that it provided an unlimited kind of moratorium. So whenever a company, which was an industrial company, and which lost 50% of the net worth and could file in the BFR for registration. And as we all know, most of us may be the chartered accountant, writing off or like reducing net worth can be due to a business problem, can be due to diversion also. So many companies landed in BFR deliberately by reducing their net worth. And ultimately they got an unlimited moratorium. So bank cannot take any action, any coercive action against the company. That was the predicament of BFR, which ultimately led to its withdrawal. Then came 1993, the RDDB Act, or the recovery of debt due to bank. This was again a very well drafted act, especially from the point of view of bankers. It came with strict timelines, but ultimately DRTs were set up, DRAT was set up. It also failed to deliver because again the courts got bogged down in the processes of the delays, and the people got smarter and they could go for forum shopping. Like if we go to DRT, bank go to DRT, they get us stay from high court, and all those things happened. Ultimately, the condition of DRT Act today is that the average recovery from DRT, as per the recent RBI report on financial sector stability, financial stability report, it is something like 3 to 5% over a period of 7 to 9 years. So that is the BRT or RDDB Act. So obviously it has not remained a very attractive act for the banks. Then in 2001 came the CDR, Corporate Debt Restructuring. So this was again a very good act. And here basically the major change which the government provided was that it was not exactly an act, it was an informal or a formal arrangement under the RBI circular. So one CDR cell was created and they were given the power to formalize a restructuring plan. And then if the 75% of the banks by value and 60% by number, they agree to the plan, restructuring plan, so it was implemented. This was a very good mechanism. It worked for some time. Many companies, if you, I don't know how many of you remember, SR Steel was initially restructured under this mechanism. And even the Jindal Vijayanagar, SR Steel, many steel plants were revived because they were stuck in sometime in 2001, and they were revived due to this CDR mechanism. Many other companies also got revived. But ultimately, again, the bankers and the professional became adept at manipulating the mechanism, and it became more of a evergreening mechanism ultimately. So CDR also lost its this thing. I'll come to that again. Then came the SARFAESI Act in 2002. This was basically launched because banks were facing a lot of problem in recovering loans through the court process. So government came out with this very strong act, which gave the bankers some powers of the courts, basically to just give a notice and attach an asset and sell it in the market, which was a very, very strong law. It was contested in the courts, and ultimately, due to one or two judgments from the Supreme Court and some changes, it lost its teeth. And today, the condition under SARFAESI is that when we take an account to SARFAESI, again, from the RBI Financial Stability Report, the recovery from SARFAESI around 13 to 15% over a period of 3 to 5 years. Then came the RBI restructuring framework, which we call the GLF framework under the corrective action plan. Again, this was in 2014. This also worked for some time. Basically, this took care of the problem that bankers and other creditors were not coming together on a same platform. And hence, the promoters were taking advantage of multiple lending lenders. So the GLF put all the lenders on the same platform. But again, this also didn't work too well. And it also led to some delay in declaring the NPA. But nothing much came out of this. Then another scheme RBI tried was strategic debt restructuring, SDR scheme. In most of these schemes, as I see, is that the restructuring was never deep. And the tendency of the borrower was not to invest further money, because many of the cases, the problem arises from the diversion of funds. And in some cases where there was genuine default, even I think the many of the promoters were not sure that due to the existing lopsided capital structure of the company, they may be able to survive. And the bankers were more interested in not getting the account classified as NPA. So these schemes became a victim of this kind of thinking from both RP process. The timeline for completing the process is 180 days, which can be extended by another 90 days with a special petition to NCLT. And once the process starts, within 1 month of the initiation or commencement of CIRP, the IRP is supposed or expected to constitute a COC consisting of all the financial creditors. This COC votes on multiple agendas, and the votes are decided on the basis of the exposure of each creditor. And this the exposure is decided on the basis of the claim filed by the creditor. And what is claim? Claim is the amount outstanding on the date of commencement of CIRP. So if my account was NPA in 2017 and I started the CIRP on 1st March 2020, so I will take that outstanding and the interest from that date, from date of NPA to the date of the commencement of CIRP, I will add both these things and then file a claim. And my voting share in the COC will be decided by total claims and my ratio of my claim to the total claim. That will be my share. So this is basically the structure of IBC. Now how it gets the restructuring? So now the IP prepares a statement of affairs of the company, which is called information memorandum. And he shares this memorandum with the COC. And then he goes to the market, makes a public notice that this is a asset, this is a company available for sale or for change of management. And if anybody is interested, they may bid for it. So he invites expression of interest. Once the market players come back with some expression of interest, he signs a non-disclosure agreement with them and shares the information memorandum. So each investor or each company who is interested in this will go through the IM, they will go make a visit to the company, they see the assets, they find out the market value of the company, and they will submit a RFRP request for to the actual bid to the IRB. These bids are tested by the COC and the RP. One of the tests of eligibility is that the existing promoters cannot bid for their company unless they are a MSME category. So this was another major change which came in the IBC, which changed the rule of the game, because many of the defaulting borrowers, including some large ones, so they tried to manipulate the process. What they thought that why not we bid our own company through this process and get my company back at maybe 20 or 30% of the exposure. So I'll be free from all the problem. But then I think government saw to this problem and they introduced their section 29A, which barred the promoters whose accounts were NPA or who are willful defaulters. There are 1230 disqualifications. They cannot bid for their company. So this is the law. Then once the investor is convinced that it's a good proposal, he will submit a resolution plan. So coming back to restructuring, this resolution plan is actually the restructuring plan under IBC. The beauty or the originality of this resolution plan as against the restructuring plans or resolution plan under any other mechanism is that the IBC gives full freedom to COC to accept any kind of plan for the revival of this company or rescue of this company. So this includes maybe the conversion of 95% of the debt into equity, maybe writing off or taking a haircut of 90% or even 99% of the total exposure. So they can do anything. So there are no...
You are in now?
Oh, no.
You are in?
I will unmute.
No, you are in now? Are you inside?
Yes, so, sorry, Sanjeev. Yeah.
So basically, this is the kind of deep restructuring which was missing in all other schemes like BFR, CDR, where banks were reluctant to go for a big haircut or a deep restructuring which can actually revive the unit. So the focus was more on the protecting the account from getting NPA. Here, it is an actual restructuring by two ways. First of all, banks are, as per the Act of Parliament and as this plan is approved by a court, so they are under no obligation to limit their discount or haircut to certain amount. So it can be anything which is viable and feasible. The plan has to be viable and feasible. So ultimately, any resolution plan which makes the CD work in future, this will be an acceptable plan. And another beauty of this, unless the banks or the COC are able to get a resolution plan within this 180 or 270 days, it has to go into a compulsory liquidation. So that is the Damocles sword hanging on the head, unless you decide quickly, because under CDR, banks used to take months together and some banks would still stay out, you know, we will not approve. So there was no cram down. Here in this process, if the 66% of the COC approves any plan, there is a cram down proposal mechanism where it has to be accepted by all of them, including the dissenting raters. It has to be accepted by everybody. That is one thing. And then it has, of course, taken the interest of all the stakeholders, including operational creditors, financial creditors. So IBC explains that resolution plan should have basic criteria where it should provide the liquidation value to the operational creditors, and dissenting creditors should be taken care of. So this is basically the restructuring under IBC. I think it has done wonderful job, especially to see the revival of companies like Bhushan Steel, which is like Tata BSL today, You see SR Steel, which is, I think, Nippon, AMC Nippon today. They are within 1 year of their change of management, they are into profits, they are running EBITDA. And we have been able to save a considerable number of jobs. And as Mr. Narendra shared initially, almost 20 to 22% of the cases which were referred to NCLT have been resolved through IBC, through CIP process. And we got a recovery of around 45 to 55%. For State Bank, it is more than 50%. So average recovery for industry is around 45%. So that is the resolution under IBC. Let me come to the resolution under the RBI framework. So RBI came out, as I said earlier, in a framework in February 2018, but that was challenged in the court because the framework said that unless you decide on the restructuring resolution within 6 months, it has to be compulsory taken into IBC. So there the court said that RBI cannot force a creditor to go to IBC, basically. That was one flaw they found in the circular. And second thing, they say that the resolution has to be provided, some option to be provided outside the court. So basically, the RBI came out with a revised circular on June 7, 2019, where it fundamentally changed the structure by saying that, okay, now banks are free to take the company to IBC or not to take the company to IBC. Only they will have some disincentive by way of additional provision. If they don't take it to IBC, let them provide some additional provision and we are okay with that. So the circular says that on the occurrence of default, one major change was again here, was that from previous schemes of NPA date, this moved to a default date as the date of trigger. So if in a consortium account, if there is a default with any of the bank, then that bank will notify all the banks. RBI has set up a mechanism where weekly level, all the defaults and all the status of accounts are reported to the RBI in respect of all accounts above 5 crore. So they come to know the default immediately. So within 30 days of the default occurring, all the member banks of the JLF or the funding banks, they will sit together and decide on a proposed resolution approach to this account. What do they want to do? Whether they want to go for a restructuring or they want to go for a resolution under IBC, or the promoter is coming back with the OTS, so they can rectify the irregularity through OTS, or even rectification of irregularity also. These are all kind of resolution possible under the ICA framework. After the review period, if the banks are not able to decide within 30 days, then they have to immediately go to IBC or provide additional provision. But if they decide within 30 days, okay, we are going in for a resolution plan outside of IBC, they get another 6 month timeline to finalize the plan and implement the plan. So basically banks get 180 plus 30 days from the date of default to decide on a resolution plan. Then plan here also similar to IBC has to provide for payment of at least liquidation value to the dissenting creditors. Credit rating agencies, so bank has to go for a independent credit evaluation, ICE, through some approved credit rating agencies. And for up to 100 crore accounts, one ICE rating is required, above 100 crore, two ratings are required. And any delay in implementing a resolution plan will entail penal provisions. As I said, on the right side, you can see post 210 days, 20%, post 365 days, another 15%, and total additional provision will be 35%. This is over and above the IRAC provision, which is provided as per aging of the account. Immediate upgradation of account is possible in case of change of ownership. So this is another new feature where in case the banks are able to find a buyer, investor in this company, and there is a change of management, then immediately the account can be upgraded to a standard category after restructuring. And if the restructuring is with the existing management, then there are certain conditions to be met before account can be upgraded. And that is the last condition. See, if satisfactory credit performance during the monitoring period. Monitoring period is again defined as something when 20% of the provision, the exposure is returned, and then only the account can be upgraded to the standard position. So these are further salient features of the scheme. Date of default is day 30, end of review period, day 210, end of implementation period of resolution plan. Day 365, if the plan is not implemented, then penal provisions are attracted. Then end of monitoring period, upgradation to standard after 10% payment. So earlier in the previous circular, it was 20%. Now it is 10% of the total debt. It is not only the bank debt. It can be the debt including the NCDs or any outside debt also. So total 10% of the total debt should be repaid. Then only the account can be upgraded to standard category. And payment of 20% of the sum of account debt and or specified period. So the specified period stops with the payment of 20% of the total debt. So here, how we go about it, outline of ICA. Basically, we start with the lead lender who can appoint a process or resolution advisor to formulate a RP. So some consultancy firm or some resolution professional can be engaged who will prepare a resolution plan. They will sit with the promoter or the new investor and they'll prepare a resolution plan and they'll come back to the JLF or the bankers consortium and they'll show the plan. Then once the plan is approved by 75% by value and 60% by number, this plan, again, similar to IBC, it is a cram down provision is there. So it will be binding on all the lenders. So this is a good new provision. Then next problem could have been that any of the bankers during the formulation of plan can go to IBC just by breaking the ranks. So this mechanism provides a standstill clause in the ICA agreement. So this ICA is basically agreement, inter-creditor agreement, is signed by all the bankers within the first 30 days. And this standstill clause is there that no legal action, including proceeding under IBC by any lender during implementation of RP shall be done, and RP shall provide for payment of not less than liquidation value. Here RP is resolution plan. So not less than liquidation value to the dissenting lenders. This is a slightly tricky condition because then some of the lenders strategically try to dissent to get a better value because the resolution plan can be valued less than the liquidation value. So they will get a minimum liquidation value. So that is one of the problem. But otherwise, this is the standstill clause. And resolution process can be terminated if approved by the majority lender. So anytime during this process or even after the resolution plan is approved, if a majority of the lenders think that plan is not being implemented properly, so it can be terminated by a majority of lenders. So restructuring options can be as under, these are the basic option in restructuring now. So I told you about two options. So under the framework, either it can be rectification. So when there is a default, the promoter can come back and say that I can rectify the account within say 15 days or 20 days. And if he is able to remove the irregularity, then it is okay. And the account can go back to the standard category. Then debt restructuring. Here restructuring can be in two forms, sustainable debt and unsustainable debt. So the balance debt, unsustainable debt may have to be converted to convertible or optionally convertible instruments. They can be like of period up to say 20 years also. And sustainable debt is the debt which is based on the future cash flows, expected cash flows of the company during the repayment period, which have to be treated at a very, very conservative level. And all the debt that can be serviced through those cash flows, that is the sustainable debt. So basic debt is divided into these two parts, and unsustainable is converted into deep discount bond or convertible bond, optionally OCDs, which can carry an interest rate of maybe 0.1% or 1%. And basically they are not to be returned in maybe 10, 15, 20 years. Lastly, but not least, the one-time settlement. This can also be a one of the resolution option. So as we can see below, elongated repayment schedule as per cash flows and economic life of the assets, reduction, step up of interest rate can happen, funding of overdue interest can happen. These are all the ways restructuring is normally done, that interest is carved out overdue interest and interest during repayment period carved out into a FITL. So this can be paid over 7 to 10 years. Working capital irregularity, like CC limit if it is irregular. The regular portion is carved out into a working capital term loan, which elongated repayment. So basically what is done is that only the sustainable part of debt is kept. Working capital limits, which are covered by the drawing power, they are only kept. All other are converted into a term loan. And then term loans are deferred to a period which are sustainable. Conversion of unsustainable debt into convertible, optionally convert debt. Direct conversion to equity preference share is also possible. And additional priority debt on selective basis. So that is one more provision which is new to IBC as well as RBI framework. Earlier, the bankers were not very comfortable in giving any further money to the defaulting borrower. But under this scheme, the banks can give additional funds and which will stay as a standard asset. Because earlier the concern was that if I give additional money, one, it will be putting good money after bad money. And second, it will become more NPA. So if I have 100 rupees already NPA and I give more 20 rupees. So I have 120 rupee NPA on my books. But as per the RBI scheme, this framework, as well as IBC, any additional limit given to the company to sustain operations is treated as interim finance or additional finance, and that can remain standard during the implementation of the plan. Now let me come briefly to the RBI framework under COVID. So as RBI framework was already active due to COVID, sudden pressure came off on the economy and all the borrowers. So RBI said, okay, we have to come out with a special framework for revival. So they provided a window under the prudential framework for revival of real sector activities and only to impact to the borrowers who were impacted by COVID-19. So why was it required? First, financial stress because of COVID, impacting the long-term viability of many firms, otherwise having a good track record. So these companies were originally viable, but because of the forced lockdown, they lost the viability and they had to be brought into a viable category again. Debt burden of borrowers becoming disproportionate as the cash flows stopped suddenly and the interest kept on applying. So the debt repayment capacity of the borrowers was distorted. So this was another reason. And such widespread impact could pair the entire recovery process. So basically it was not only one company, it was the entire ecosystem which was disturbed. So that's why this COVID framework was required. Key features are facilities extended only to the borrowers having a stress on account of COVID, enables lending institution to implement resolution plan without change of ownership while classifying the account as standard. So this is a fundamental difference between the RBI framework and the COVID framework. Here, without change of management, if we do some kind of restructuring or some resolution under the COVID framework, even with the existing management, the account can remain standard. So this circular of RBI is to be read in conjunction with RBI circulars like June 15, IRAC norm circular, prudential framework circular, then March 27 COVID regulatory package, and COVID-19 April regulatory package. So these are all to be read together with this COVID framework. Eligibility and applicability, eligible to all lending institutions in like commercial banks, urban cooperative banks, state cooperative banks, all India financial institutions, all non-banking finance companies, including housing finance companies. These are all covered under this framework. It is not borrowers, credit facilities, not eligible are these SME borrowers, farm credit, financial service providers, loan for on lending, exposure to central state government, local government, housing finance companies where account has been rescheduled. So these are not covered under this framework. Borrowers eligible for our resolution plan under this circular are basically accounts which were classified as standard but not in default for more than 30 days with any lending institution as on 1st March 2020. So that means any account which was not in default from 1st February or maybe 29th January, it's up to not more than 30 days of default as on March 1, they can be covered. Plus, account should be continued to remain standard till the date of invocation. So it should not have turned into an NPA category. So 90 days should not have passed from the date of default, and the stress should be on account of COVID. Guidelines for borrowers other than the personal loans are basically these. So guidance for invoking RP. So basically the borrower has to approach the bank by invoking the resolution mechanism. He say he may submit a request for invoking RP under the circular. So if there is a single lending institution, decision is taken as per the board approved policy. So banks have been asked to prepare policies for this kind of this COVID framework. If with multiple lending, then it is to be under the ICA framework. As I said, 75% value, 60% by number. The resolution under this framework may be invoked no later than 31st December 2020. The resolution must be implemented within 180 days from the date of invocation. For the ICA framework, it can be used. Timeline is to be signed within 30 days from the date of invocation. So as against the date of default, here the ICA can be signed within 30 days from date of invocation. Failure to sign as ICA within 30 days, invocation shall lapse if the ICA is not signed. 30 days and the lender is given at least 75% by value and 60% by number, they don't approve, then this will lapse. And then this framework cannot be invoked. Lenders other than a specified lending institution and dispute redressal, they can also join this ICA, like the mutual funds, the bond trustees, they can also join the ICA in invoking this framework. Key features of resolution plan, basically additional facilities can be provided to address the financial stress. Interim finance may also be provided, which will remain standard. Tenor can be extended of the loan, so reschedule and given further time for repayment. Credit rating is required if exposure is 100 crore above. Conversion debt to equity is possible. And valuation to be done as per IRAC norms. And conversion into any other security other than equity or NCD will be valued at ₹1. Asset classification provisioning. So under this framework, upgraded to standard asset or maintained as standard asset based on the time-bound implementation of the plan. Additional finance as well as the restructured debt to be treated as standard asset only if resolution plan implemented within stipulated timelines. If not implemented within the timeline, additional finance would be classified as per actual performance toward additional finance. So provisioning and reversal, provisioning held by ICA lenders shall be as per the extant IRAC norms before implementation or 10% of the total debt, whichever is higher. So here there is a provision of two provisions, like either it will be as per IRAC norms or 10% of total debt. So if next is non-ICA lender immediately upon 30 days from invocation to provide 20% provision as per IRAC norms. Provision required to be made as part of RBI COVID-19 package may be utilized for meeting the provision requirement. So any other provision made as per RBI COVID-19 regulatory package can also be used for the purpose of this provision. Reverse half of the provision upon payment of 20% of the residual debt. So this is basically the specified period. If the 20% of the debt is paid and remaining half upon payment of additional 10% of the debt, then the additional provision can be written back. Default post implementation, in case there is a default post implementation, then any default during monitoring period shall trigger a review period of another 30 days. If borrower continues to be default post end of review period with any lender, account shall be downgraded to NPA for all lenders from the date of implementation of RP. Further upgradation possible only post restructuring as per prudential framework. So once there is a default under the resolution plan under this framework and it is not treated within the 30 days, then any upgradation is possible. The bank has to go back to the RBI resolution framework and post restructuring only will be possible. So again, there is one more this thing. The RBI constituted a committee for different industries to provide some guidance for particular industries. And this committee was headed by Mr. K.V. Kamath, ex-ICICI Bank Chairman, and Divakar Gupta, Ashwin Parekh, T.N. Manoharan. And RBI said that the compensation, the EC shall have its secretariat at the IBA. Expenses compensation shall be borne by RBI and they were supposed to notify the parameters. And they will do the vetting of the resolution plans. So this framework, this committee is already in existence. They are working on the plans. And one, they have provided some indications like this. They have said that basically 5 ratios, they are providing guidance on these. These are total outside liability to adjusted TNW, total debt to EBITDA, current ratio, debt service coverage ratio, and average debt service coverage ratio. These are the 5 ratios on which they are providing the standard parameters. And this slide shows the how what are the parameters suggested by this committee. As you can see, for different industries, they have provided different parameters. Some industry, I think recently, the aviation industry has come back to the government that they want some relaxation in these parameters. But annual rate, these are the parameters suggested by the committee. Another consideration for implementing the RP, that graded approach of COVID-19 impact, lenders may adopt a graded approach toward preparing and implementing RP. Such graded approach may be mental classification of impact on borrowers, mild, moderate, severe. So these are all guidance for the for formulating in, internal policies for the banks. Then ICA and escrow compliance, signing of ICA within 30 days is mandatory. Escrow account may be maintained by the at the project SPV level. So for a company with multiple SPVs, different escrows can be maintained. Compliance shall be assessed for lending institution as part of supervisory review. Ratios will be monitored, compliance to be monitored on ongoing basis. Any such breach not rectified within a reasonable period to be considered a financial difficulty. TOL, TNW to be maintained on the date of implementation as well as till March 31, 2020. So this ratio is very, very crucial. This has to be maintained up to 22. All other ratios shall be maintained as per RP by March 31, 2022 and on an ongoing basis thereafter. And it further says that studies to be conducted before RP implementation wherever possible. So there has to be evaluation report from 1 or 2 valuers. A techno-economic viability study has to be conducted. Stock and receivable audit has to be conducted. And ICE, independent credit evaluation from an external CRA, has to be got for account more than 100 crores. So now this is the comparison between the two framework, like RBI framework and the COVID regulatory framework. So basically, you see the difference that in the RBI framework, default and commencement of review period, resolution or recovery is possible. Resolution process to be completed within 180 days. If implemented, then monitoring period starts. And after monitoring period, 20% of debt repaid or 10% of total debt repaid, upgrade of account. And if not implemented, it will become an NPA and the process will start accordingly. Under under COVID-19 default, basically the default has to be caused by the COVID-19 fallout. If yes, then relaxation can be provided as outlined in the COVID-19 regulatory framework. Default in this case shall not be considered as financial difficulty as defined in the RBI circular of prudential framework for that is June 7, 19 circular. Relief is specifically to tide over the economic fallout of COVID-19. So these are the basic difference between the two frameworks. Income recognition will apply, this 15 circular of RBI will apply as it is, and the provisioning requirement as shown here. So now let us see what will be the impact of this situation on the IBC cases. So basically the problem which has happened because of the change of the limit from 1 lakh to 1 crore, considered view is that the 1 crore limit applies only to for prospective filings. So now some of the clarification has come from the NCLT that the cases filed before this change or the default which have happened before this date of notification, and the application has been filed in NCLT already but not yet admitted, there this change will not apply. So basically if a petition was filed sometime in February and the default was less than 1 crore, that will sustain, that application will sustain.
seeing many situations where factories or other locked down or operating at a minimum staff and going through the business continuing planning, value preservation is a challenge here. Because in many cases, the CRPs were delayed due to the closure of NCLTs and the deferment of the 180-day process. So we are seeing some challenges. Then there is a problem of many of the resolution applicant backing out. We have already filed a plan. Plans are before NCLTs for consideration. Now, because of COVID, they see that the valuations have gone down. So they are slightly backing out. That is another problem banks are facing under IBC. So this is all on restructuring. I think briefly I'll cover TPAC. If given, do I have time for this? Sandeep ji?
Yes, so we can actually take some questions. And by the way, I should thank you, Anil ji. Your presentation has been very good. Everyone has been appreciating, and the way the clarity what you have brought out on the discussion has been pretty good. We can have some questions which have been coming over. Sir, there is one question from Mr. Prakash Agarwal, where he talked about what happens in case the borrower is in regular payment, but ratios are not maintained by the person. We have situations where we are not able to maintain the ratios.
So, come again, promoter is in regular payment.
The what happens in case the borrower is in regular payment, but the ratios are not maintained. Okay. You have specified certain ratios, the five ratios, what you are talking about.
Yeah. So basically, if you see, we call it a technical default. If ratios are not compliant, but there is no default in the account. So as I understand, there is no default yet. Only a technical default because of the some coherence of ratios. So I think India, we don't treat them as a default as of now, as per the framework or IBC. Yeah. As of now, it is only a actual default of repayment. That is considered for initiation of. So technical default is as yet not a default.
Okay.
The account will remain standard.
No account will remain standard. Okay. Can I request RTG to take it up, please? BS RTG.
Thank you, Sandeep. Thank you. So after Sanjeev ji has given a wonderful presentation, I don't think much is left to speak. He has covered almost every element of restructuring and IBC. A couple of points that we have not seen any great response to COVID restructuring scheme of RBI. So one of the reasons which we have realized is that the RBI, expert committee norms, which have been specified, are little tough for corporate to for achieve. We had one question also that if account is regular but ratios are not being met. So that type of situation we have seen in many cases. One of the requirement is that this EBITDA ratio should be 5 times, EBITDA should be five, minimum five, the total loan outstanding should be minimum of 5 times of EBITDA. So particularly these sectors which have faced the problems like hotels and tourism, so they're getting this 5 ratio, it's very difficult. Nobody works on that type of ratio. And second thing is March 22, the expert committee suggested that these ratios to be achieved by March 23, but RBI has preponed it to March 22. So that is one thing which has created issue, and that's why so not many companies have gone for this. The second point is that even though the account remains standard, the banks have to provide 10%, and in many cases banks have been reluctant to consider restructuring. Rather, they have suggested that we will give some short-term funding, additional funding, instead of doing this restructuring. So that's why we have seen that this scheme has not been that popular. Fortunately, economy has picked up very well. Those who were having problems prior to COVID, they will continue to have problem. But the fresh cases have not been that much. In fact, even the hotel industry is also looking up. Yesterday only I was reading the newspaper that all the hotels in North India, Manali and other places are having 100% occupancy. So hopefully these sectors will also sail through, pass through. The problem is for the companies which were facing problem prior to COVID. So for that, there was a demand that RBI gave some relaxation. See, prior to 2015, Mr. Pandey will vouch that, prior to 2015, one time restructuring was allowed without account getting downgraded to NPA. But RBI said, Mr. Raghuram Rajan was the main person who was instrumental in getting this policy. He said that there is no point in pretending that you are good and healthy. If you are not, you admit it. Let account be NPA upon restructuring. And once it is crosses 1 year of satisfactory performance, you will be again upgraded. What is the problem in making it NPA? But the problem was that banks had capital issues. They didn't want account to be made NPA. And so many cases are there where banks didn't do restructuring in time. And the problems compounded. And today, that is one of the reasons that we are seeing so many cases under IBC. So this is all I wanted to say in a brief time I am allowed.
Thank you very much. Wonderful insight. I would just like to add, Mr. Pandeji, we have discussed at length about IBC and also the transparency which bids are invited and should be invited. So there is a equal opportunity to all the bidders to participate in the India growth story. I would like to share particularly transparency issues. I had an extensive interaction with the MD of Tata Steel and CFO of Tata Steel in respect of their bids for Bhushan Steel, which has been among the largest cases. Particularly for bankers, it was a very good experience story. But in respect of transparency, lot of pains were taken by Tata Steel management, the CEO and the CFO, Mr. Narendra and Mr. Kaushik Chatterjee, and explaining how it was a good acquisition, about the cash flows and about the additional capex being done also. The house, the company was willing to put additional capex to make it a very globally competitive company in terms of EBITDA per ton and cost per ton. But we find this is missing from many, many other promoters. We have been talking about the corporate series, the good, the bad, and the ugly. What can be done to ensure highest level of transparency so that we get the best bids, bankers have the maximum advantage, and also all the stakeholders, they know that it can be a very, very good story and maximum value addition and unlocking the value.
TRPs to take over the transaction through a open bidding, which is offered to maybe 100, 200 IPs of at that particular center. So that is again a transparent process. The entire marks are given for different credits. And then a best person is selected. Then comes the EOI process. It is very transparent. Advertisement is given in one national daily and a local daily. Then IM is available to all who are able to sign the NDA with the RP. And for both the COC and as well as the investor, they can ask for any information from the RP. So as per law, they are entitled to get any information. Of course, other than some trade secrets, which the RP will not disclose in the process, other than trade secrets or some key information, RP is able to show around and show the information to the bidders. And COC can demand any information. So I feel that this entire process is built into a transparent process. Maybe going forward, if we go for the pre-pack kind of a situation where the banks go with a pre-packaged plan to NCLT, I think there will be some challenges of transparency. So my take is that it was very transparent, including the RBI framework also, because it is a for only known to the bankers or the borrowers. As we all, I knew the bank is holding so much NPA, which account is NPA, market never knew. But today, after the introduction of IBC, every person on the street knows that SR Steel is in insolvency. SR Steel was sold for so much. It's there in the next day's newspaper. Okay. Bhushan Steel banker had to suffer. More than 80%, everybody knows in the market. So that is the transparency which has been brought in by the IBC, and I think which is good for the system, because we cannot hide behind certain curtains. Everybody is exposed.
Can you add your thoughts on transparency issues, and then we'll have excellent insights on restructuring from you.
Amlay, if he has any specific questions.
Yes, sir. Like... Yeah.